The very first time we've had a password was on this computer, an IBM 7094 in MIT in the late 50s, early 60s. The very first time we had a password breach was on an IBM 7094 at MIT in the late 50s, early 60s.
Humans are really bad at creating randomness. So when it comes to creating passwords and remembering passwords, they're generally, if they're made by humans, not very strong.
Passwords safeguard some of our most valuable data, much like a lock and key might secure your physical valuables. Passwords rely on keys too, but not to open a mechanical lock. Instead, they use complex patterns or algorithms to scramble the answer through a process called encryption, in a way that only the system on the other end can decode. At least that's how it's supposed to work. From the start, passwords have had flaws. The first password system was broken within months. As password techniques have improved, so have methods for defeating them, which begs the question, why do we keep relying on passwords? Security experts say that a passwordless future has mostly been held back by available technology. To understand how we get there, let's take a look back at the 1,000-year arms race to keep society's secrets safe, way back to Rome during the reign of Julius Caesar, who is credited with creating one of history's best-known ciphers.
A Caesar cipher is a type of simple substitution cipher. And we don't just replace the letter A with any old symbol or any old letter. We replace A by shifting it down the alphabet. Now, a classic Caesar cipher shifts by three places. So A becomes B, C, D. A becomes D. Overall, this is not a great way to send secret messages. But you can make the Caesar cipher absolutely brutally strong. You can transform it into something called the Visionaire cipher.
The Visionaire cipher uses a new Caesar cipher for each letter of the message, switching according to a keyword known only to the sender and receiver. This increase in complexity makes it much harder to decode because the number of possible solutions for the message increases by a power of 10 for each letter in the code word.
It became known as le chiffre indéchiffrable, the cipher that's indecipherable. And for decades, I think perhaps even centuries, it was unbroken. In the 20th century, we start having radio being used, particularly in warfare, particularly in the battlefield. The problem with radio is that anybody can tune into your radio frequency and hear what you're saying. And that's why you have the development of mechanical encryption devices, most famously of all, the Enigma cipher machine.
The Germans' Enigma machine used an intricate set of wheels and rotors to scramble communications. It was much harder to crack than even Visionaire. If a codebreaker tried one possibility every minute, finding the right combination by chance would take longer than the age of the universe. But by the end of the war, the Allies did manage to defeat Enigma, giving them the upper hand and paving the way for computerized encryption.
Encryption used to be about governments and the military. And now, encryption is about our everyday lives. The devices we're using are using encryption.
Instead of battle plans and secret plots, passwords safeguard access to our bank accounts, our medical records, our social media profiles. Attackers have made a $1 billion industry out of cracking, capturing, or conning users into revealing their passwords.
We're relying on something that people are not good at. Remembering a long thing and doing it repeatedly over a very long term. Not something that the human mind is designed to do.
I have to remember a bunch, I have to rotate them, I have to keep making them longer and more complicated. All those things make it harder for me. And then I also just don't like to type them. It's annoying for my fingers.
We've made passwords longer and more complicated in an effort to make them more secure. But that also makes them harder to remember, leading many people to do unsafe things like reuse them or worse, write them on a post-it note that they leave at their desk.
Passwords rely on something that the user knows, and that worked really well in a physical space. As soon as we digitize that, how users interact with these systems is through a computer. And so these are all machine-to-machine communications. What we've done is allowed machines to be able to impersonate humans and try to crack passwords. Although password cracking has existed for decades prior, Moore's law being as it is, This has been an exponential increase year over year of the amount of password guesses or attempts that can be tried.
Where passwords really get weak is when they're being shared or stored across someone else. Once it leaves your device and it's on someone else's device. If an attacker breaches their database, which has your password in it, well, now it could be used in a lot of other places.
With most of our systems protected by passwords, making them safer has been a primary goal of security experts. The first password system kept a list of passwords in an unencrypted text file, but users quickly discovered that they could use that file to access everyone's accounts. Researchers responded by developing hashing, which took those passwords and encrypted them using an intricate but repeatable formula. Once hackers became adept at figuring out the algorithm, this hashing method was again refined with a process called salting. Just like older ciphers added arbitrary letters to throw off would-be code breakers, salting added an arbitrary number of dummy characters to the password before encryption, requiring an attacker to figure out both the encryption and salting pattern used. Today, the exponential growth of malware and phishing attacks means that despite the most modern protections, nearly anyone can become a target, from individuals to global corporations. Perhaps most concerningly is the increase in password dumps, where massive databases of stolen passwords are shared among attackers, even bundled for more convenient use. The largest of these bundles, RockYou 2021, included 8.4 billion passwords, more than one for every person on Earth. Phishing and malware attacks can be difficult to defend against because they exploit human psychology as well as computer vulnerabilities. While many in information security see users as an unfixable problem, a growing number of experts disagree. Instead, they say the problem is that security systems aren't designed with users in mind.
Most of the attacks that you've seen usually start nowadays with a phishing attack. The attack is coming from within the house, you know? It's like because someone inadvertently let them in. They're not an insider threat deliberately. They're your insider threat by accident, by sometimes good intentions. I've fallen for fish. We need to get past this point where it's like, oh, no one should ever fall for a fish. It's like, no. Stigmatizing that and saying like, well, that would never happen to me, means you've never detected it. You never noticed it.
Modern security systems with multiple layers of protection can help safeguard against phishing and other attempts to exploit user psychology. Along with something you know, your password, they can also require something you have, like your phone, or something that you are, like your fingerprint.
One of the ways that we've moved towards to protect authentication is multi-factor. So it's a series of different factors, one of them being that password. Along the way, we realized, do we even need the password? If we've got different factors, stronger factors to rely on.
In the passwordless flow, we're eliminating that first factor, where you're entering the password. I'm going straight to that second factor, where you interact with a key or a biometric device.
The common availability of mobile phones with fingerprint readers or facial recognition was an important step in making passwordless access practical. The other vital element was behind the scenes, the development of universal authentication standards, which basically means the same rules are used across many different types of computer systems and applications. No matter whether you're using a desktop computer or a mobile device, a Mac or a PC. One important standard is called WebAuthn. It was developed to make it easier for websites to use passwordless methods of authentication. Putting these pieces together moved passwordless from a promising concept towards a reality.
In the case where you actually have to enter a password, anyone can enter your password from anywhere. This is why it's so great for attackers. You or anyone else can enter it from anywhere in the world. Once you add that WebAuthn layer, once you add the second factor, you need to be within proximity of the device that is in charge of your credential.
But as passwordless options become more widely available, so do some persistent myths about how it works.
One would be that it just removes the password and doesn't add anything else to it. It's actually adding in that cryptographic key and the secondary factor of the biometric or PIN. Another myth is around the security or privacy with biometrics.
Typically, users are concerned with the idea of, I don't want my fingerprint out on the internet. I don't want my iris imprint on the internet. Because these are authentication factors that people cannot change. So in the same way that when your identity is stolen and your social security number is sold online, that's a difficult value to change. In fact, you don't. You just put additional safeguards in to protect you after that.
Basically, what I tell people is the authentication provider never needs to see your biometric. We don't store any of them. And the reason for that is it's performed locally at the device you're using as an authenticator.
There's the feeling of security and the reality of security. For passwordless to be successful, we have to address both. And there are some very real concerns about biometrics. There's some very real concerns about people's data. What I like about most passwordless technologies is they keep that data in people's pockets. They keep that data in people's hands.
So, what does this passwordless future look like, and what do we still need to get there?
One way in which the technology is going to evolve or continue to evolve that will make passwordless more adaptable is the multi-device credential or cross-platform credential. So the way passwordless works right now is you have a biometric on a device. Let's use the example of your MacBook, and you have a Touch ID on there. Where the technology is going is you can use a credential that's been created on your mobile device, on your phone, maybe it's Apple or Android, and you can use that whether it's a Mac device, a Chromebook, a Windows device, and that makes it really easy because you're carrying around basically a wallet of credentials that you can use at any device that you walk up to.
We've had standards for authentication forever, but they weren't linked up to the biometrics. We've had multi-factor forever, but those things weren't coming together to remove the password from primary authentication. The future arrives out of order because different components get invented at different ways. And really the big innovation comes when you've got ubiquity of the hardware, when you've got the cultural acceptance, and you've got the standards to bring everything together. And I believe that flashpoint is where we are at today with passwordless.